Hello, everyone. In a few short moments, the program will begin. Please silence all phones and look to the front.
Hola a todos. En unos momentos, el programa va a empezar. Por favor, apaguen sus teléfonos y miren hacia el frente. Gracias.
One more time. In a few short moments, the program will begin. Please shut down all cellular devices and look to the front. Thank you.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second annual Graduate Research Showcase. Now, is that a mouthful? I'm here alongside my co-MC, Eric Sleiman. Woo! Eric, Eric is a third-year PhD student in AI and computer science, and they're studying how AI learns social biases.
And I'm privileged to be here as co-MC with Karina Puente. Karina is our MC for the first half of today's talks and a third-year PhD student studying underwater robotic grippers. Let's give Karina a welcome, too. Now, a few of you might think that this sounds a little bit familiar, and that's because the two of us have been here on this stage before, last year in the first ever research showcase. And we know how the folks up here in the front, we know exactly how they're feeling.
Fear not, these folks have totally blown us out of the water. If you could only see how much time and dedication they put to really make something special just for you all.
But there's more to this showcase than just what you're going to see on stage. This has been a professional development opportunity for them to learn how to be science communicators for you all in the audience, but also to learn to talk to each other, all people in the College of Engineering.
Soon you're going to be hearing from this year's cohort, 10 amazing OSU engineering grad students working on groundbreaking research. But before we begin, it is our pleasure to introduce to you on the stage our current Dean of Engineering, Scott Ashford. Woo!
Oh my gosh. Thank you, Eric and Karina, and welcome everybody on this beautiful Friday afternoon. I'm so happy to see you all, and I'm so happy that our speakers are going to share their amazing work with you today. So this showcase has been months in the making. Students have to apply, and we had over 60 applications this year. And if the students were selected, we got down selected to 10. They got to work with a speech coach, my speech coach, and they met. I think I talked to Patty, who's up somewhere. She's up in the corner. She met with the students 70 different times in preparation for these amazing talks. So why do we do all this work? It's because to broaden the impact of your research, you've got to learn how to talk about it, and not just to talk to other engineers and computer scientists, but to talk to the people that are in this room and to talk to the public and get them to understand, right, the meaningful impact that you all are going to have. It's a skill that is not just going to, it's not only going to benefit you wherever you go, whether to industry or academia, but it's going to benefit society at large. I'm so excited for these students to share what they're working on, and I'm going to turn things back over to Eric and Karina, and go Beavs!
Thank you, Dean Ashford. And now let's start our showcase presentation. Our first presenter today is Michelle G. Michelle G is a master's student in mechanical engineering. Her presentation is How Plant Chemistry Plays a Role in Wildfire. Let's have a big round of applause for Michelle. Woo!
Thanks everybody for being here. As Karina said, my name is Michelle, and today I'm gonna be talking about my research, which is how plant chemistry plays a role in wildfires. So when you think about wildfires, you probably think about something like this. Trees burning, smoke, a lot of heat, but you're probably not thinking about chemistry. But chemistry is fundamental in these processes. Chemical reactions drive combustion, and they are the reason that fuels burn. In order to understand and fight fires, we need models that incorporate chemistry. Let me take you back, August of 1949, when a wildland fire broke out in Man Gulch in Montana. It was 100 degrees on a south-facing steep hill covered in dry grass, perfect conditions for a bad fire. And a team of smoke jumpers were sent in to fight it. Suddenly, the wind picked up and the fire exploded. Estimates are that the fire covered 3,000 acres during 10 minutes during this blow-up stage. The foreman did something counterintuitive. He lit a spot fire in front of him and his men to try to burn the fuels before the fire could reach them. I don't know about you, but if I was in the situation with a fire surging toward me and my boss was in front of me and he decided to light another fire, I probably wouldn't stop to ask him what he was doing. I would run. And 12 of the men did. But the foreman's strategy worked. The fire missed him and one other man who stayed with him because it had no fuels. The men who ran away did not survive. The Man Gulch fire demonstrated that we need research into fire mechanisms, things like combustion and fuel. These boil down to chemistry and energy. And that is the focus of my research. I do computational modeling of chemistry and energy during ignition of living fuels. Now, why living fuels? Because they behave differently in a wildfire. They're chemically different. Living fuels are made of three main constituents, cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin, but they also have oils that can erupt from them during a fire like this. This video was taken by my coworker, Nate Gardner, in the Sire lab, and this is a phenomenon called droplet ejection. It's when the oils eject from the foliage during a fire and they ignite in the air or they spread fuel to neighbors. Foliage, the green part of living plants, also is very high in simple sugars. In a fire, these provide quick and intense energy. Now, when I model for wildfires, I'm modeling for something that changes over space and time. Specifically, what I look at are chemical composition or different plant species, fuel classes, difference between foliage and thin or thick branches, and the heat flux, or the amount of heat that's applied to a sample, and how varying these factors affect predictions for temperature, released gases, time to ignition, and how much of the fuels are going to burn. This results in a large system of matrices of differential equations, with hundreds of variables and equations at each time step. In order to get accurate predictions, I need good data to estimate the variables at the first time step. So to do this, I collaborate with experimentalists in my lab and at the Missoula Fire Sciences Lab in Montana. Experiments help validate my modeling approach and help me make better predictions and improvements to the model. So these are some results from an initial study that I did. On the bottom are the experimental results I was trying to simulate, and on the top are the results from the model. I matched the heat flux and the initial conditions of the experiment in the model and ran the model for the same duration of time as the experiment. And as you can see, it agreed pretty well. 2% agreement between the experiment and the model is much better than I could have hoped for, and something I've been working toward for a long time. Now, many other physics-based models with similar approaches represent forest fuels as only their three main constituents, which again are cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin. But for living fuels, this often isn't enough. So I'm going to show that on the next slide, what happens when you change the chemical composition and its effect on predictions. So these bottom two results are the same as the previous slide, and then the top three are runs where I artificially changed the chemistry in the model. So as you can see, not accounting for cellulose changes predictions by 16%. And if I use the approach that many other people use, accounting for the fuel as only cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin, it changes the predictions by 36%, 35%. So the key takeaway here is that having detailed chemistry for living fuels is very important for this type of modeling. So this is an iterative process. It's a work in progress. And while I, of course, am very excited about this approach, the truth is that large-scale wildfire models cannot handle chemistry of this detail. So my goal is to communicate and incorporate key findings from my research to add fidelity to large-scale wildfire models. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Michelle. Up next, we have Lorinda Niarco, a PhD student in environmental engineering. Lorinda's talk is on studying the impacts of heavy metals in water, a new method. Lorinda, welcome to the stage.
Thank you, Karina. And thank you all so much for being here today. I'm really excited to share with you what I've been studying. And for the past 4 years, one of my projects has been developing a new method to study how metals interact with organic compounds in water. So why are we interested in this? Here's an EPA report listing some of the things that contaminate our surface waters. As you can see, metals are third. These are metals like copper, lead, zinc, and others. And now some of you are thinking, that must be concerning. And it is. And several studies have shown that even small amounts of these metals can harm aquatic life. This brings me to my next thing. And that is when metals get into water, they like to interact with things like organic compounds. Basically, metals chemically stick to organic compounds to form metal organic complexes. These complexes often account for more than 90% of the chemical forms of metals in water. But the challenge is, we don't know what these organic compounds are, because we don't have the right method to do so. But finding a method is really complicated because these organic compounds come from a lot of sources. Some come from nature, like when plants decay, and some come from things we use every day, like cosmetics and detergents. These can all end up in our waters and can all potentially bind with metals. That is why it's important to know what these compounds are. The method we've developed is a combination of liquid chromatography and mass spectrometry. Here's our LC, which we use to separate the complexes. And we do that by taking a small amount of our sample and injecting that onto this column, which is packed with a specific material, and the complexes separate by interacting with the material on the column. But at the end of this process, we have a bunch of separated complexes, but we don't know what they are. That's what we use the mass spec for. And this is what makes our method novel, is that we use two mass spectrometers. This one quantifies the metals, which tells us how much is there. And the other one identifies the organic compounds that the metals are binding with. The first step in a mass spec is ionization, which simply means we apply some energy to charge the complexes. Then they go to a detector, where they produce a signal that we can record. The signal is based on the mass to charge ratio, which is a unique number for every individual molecule, and that's how we can determine what the complexes are. So that's it. That's our new method. And for the next few minutes, I want to show you how we've used this method to identify copper complexes in wastewater. And our main goal here was to determine if the wastewater treatment process changes the complexes there. So wastewater is actually one of the ways that heavy metals end up in our surface waters, and it also has a ton of organic compounds. So it's important to understand what happens once they get to the treatment plant. We collected three samples at three stages. First, after primary sedimentation, this is pretty much untreated wastewater. Next, after secondary sedimentation, after biological treatment, where microbes break down many contaminants. And third, after disinfection. This is the water that goes back to our rivers. So let's look at what happens after the first mass spec. On these plots, on the y-axis is the intensity of the copper complexes, which is how much is there. And on the x-axis is the retention time, and that's how we're able to pair the data from both mass specs. This overall curve is the shape of copper that is binding more with natural organic compounds. But the more a peak diverges, the more likely it's binding with man-made organic compounds. Every individual peak is a different copper complex. And the higher the peak, the higher the concentration. So what this tells us is that in the untreated wastewater, copper binds with both the natural and man-made organic compounds. So then what happens after biological treatment? As you can see in the orange curve, the complexes look different. There are fewer peaks, which means the treatment process has removed some of the complexes, which is a good thing. But there's some new ones. And the overall shape of the curve is shifted. What this tells us is that as the microbes are breaking down the contaminants, they're also creating some new organic compounds that are also sticking to copper. Now, this is where things get exciting, because we can use our second mass spec to start to determine these changes. So for example, that tall peak in the orange, what is that? We can overlay the data from both mass specs based on that retention time I told you about, and then using that M over Z value, we can predict a molecular formula. And we can even determine a structure of the molecule. An interesting fact, this chemical is actually used in the dye for blue jeans. So you know it could totally end up in wastewater. So what happens after final treatment? As you can see in that green curve, that tall peak is gone. And there are basically no individual peaks on the curve, which tells us that at the end of the treatment process, what remains in the wastewater are these complexes that are binding more with the natural organic compounds. So let's go back to our complex. We're no longer confused because we have more information on what they're made up of, thanks to this pretty awesome method. And thanks to it, we've been able to identify about 3,900 molecular formulas. And we're trying to determine structures for these molecules. But we can actually use this method for other metals and even other water sources, like the river, which would be good to know so we know what happens once the wastewater is discharged back into it. Ultimately, we hope this tool can be a valuable resource for other researchers and government agencies like the EPA to regulate metals in our water, to protect those water sources, protect our aquatic friends, and protect us. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorinda. Our next presenter today is Ana Garcia Caraveo, a PhD student in material science.
Her presentation is on micromechanical materials testing for fusion energy. Please join me in welcoming Anna to the stage.
Thank you, Karina, for the introduction, and thank you, everyone, for being here today. Have you ever imagined living in a world where carbon-free energy sources were available to everyone? Let's be honest. I think we all have. And you might wonder, but why are we not carbon-free now? Well, there are many answers to that question, but one promising solution is fusion energy. Fusion is nuclear energy, but it's not what we might think of as a common nuclear reactor. That is fission energy. Fusion is a different process. During fusion, small atoms merge, forming a plasma that creates tons of light and heat and charged particles. This is a reaction that powers stars, like our sun. So think of fusion as having a small sun inside a power reactor, sort of like this. But I want to show you how a real fusion reactor looks like. Impressive. I'm a material scientist that works with the materials that are being proposed to build these reactors, specifically the materials from the walls that are going to be facing the plasma from the fusion reaction. These walls are going to interact with a huge volume of atom size and charged particles that are going to hit it at really, really high speeds, over and over at a high temperature. So these walls are going to be under a lot of stress. And the main worry is, what is going to happen with these reactors? We're going to build them, and what's going to happen after a few years of operation? We want to know if the walls are going to crack. So we need to test this material and know the mechanical properties. Usually, to know a material's properties or to test them, we perform large-scale mechanical tests. With this, we predict how will they perform before we build anything with it. But we still need to know what the plasma is going to do to this material, right? But we don't have a sun here on Earth to do that. In nuclear material science, we irradiate materials with charged particles. These help us to simulate what is going to happen to the material in an extreme environment, something like facing a very hot plasma. But the damage from these experiments is too shallow, typically 1 to 2 microns depth. This is 75 times smaller than the diameter of a single hair. This is where we use micromechanical testing. I'm working with a tungsten composite made of tungsten particles and nickel, and we have done two different tests. The first one is nanoindentation. With nanoindentation, we use a very sharp and nano-sized diamond tip. With this, we can calculate the hardness of the materials in the composite. We did this first with the material before irradiation. That is our reference. Then we irradiate the material at a high temperature with three different conditions: helium ions, nickel ions, and then both at the same time. These are the results. As you can see, the tungsten hardness increase. And you might think, well, that's a good thing, but it's not. This means that the tungsten particles are getting damaged from the radiation, but to what extent? We need a second test. This is where we did a bending test. This test was done in the tungsten particles with the same conditions I mentioned before. These are the results. As you can see, before irradiation, the tungsten particles have a bigger fracture resistance or a higher fracture resistance. Then after irradiation, the fracture resistance drops significantly. This means that it's easier to form a crack in these tungsten particles after irradiation. These are not the results that we were expecting, but that's research. The positive thing here is that micromechanical testing has shown us to be a very powerful tool to get the mechanical properties of materials when they are exposed to extreme environments. There's still a ton of work to be done, but I can confidently say that we are getting closer to bring clean energy for everyone and ensure a cleaner future for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna. Next up, we have Amanda Ines. She is a PhD student in environmental engineering. Her presentation is on reducing antibiotic resistance in wastewater. Amanda, please welcome to the stage.
Thank you, Karina, for the introduction. As Karina said, my project is focused on reducing antibiotic resistance within the wastewater treatment process. Treatment plants were designed to clean wastewater. The challenge is treatment plants were not specifically designed to clean emerging contaminants. And a big one is antibiotic resistance. And it's a global threat. A recent UN report estimated that by 2050, we could have 10 million deaths a year just from drug-resistant infections. And one of the places where antibiotic resistance can grow is in the wastewater treatment plant. Treatment plants are highly biological environments where bacteria thrive and mingle. And we know that antibiotics and antibiotic resistance genes are present throughout the treatment plant. The goal of my project is to find an efficient and cost-effective way to reduce the spread of antibiotic resistance within the treatment plant and without adding any extra steps to the treatment process. The wastewater treatment plant is split up into two portions, solids and liquids. From the literature, we know that antibiotic resistance genes are concentrated within the solids treatment process. So I focus on the solids treatment. Solids from the primary and secondary sedimentation tanks settle out and are run through the anaerobic digester. This is what comes out of the digester, dark, sludgy, stuff that does not settle out on its own. Since this is close to the end of the treatment process, it doesn't smell too bad, at least to me. This sludge still has liquid that we need to get out. So utilities add what's called a polymer flocculant. The polymer makes the solids aggregate or clump together like this, resulting in a clear solid liquid separation. Mechanical dewatering is then used to either squeeze or spin out that final liquid. Biosolids leave the plant, while that liquid is recycled back through the treatment process. The problem is any antibiotic resistance genes still present in that liquid now is going back into the treatment process and mixes with all that new sewage that's coming in. In other words, the treatment process itself could contribute to increasing antibiotic resistance within the treatment plant. My research is to try to reduce this. I work back at that polymer flocculation step, researching which polymers and at what dose is better at reducing antibiotic resistance. Utilities have a lot of choices of polymers. I focus on two types, linear and branched. I then compared dosing of each of them. I wanted to see which polymer and at what dose could achieve an effective reduction of antibiotic resistance genes. But first, I needed to find that optimal dose, which is the amount of polymer needed to get that clearest liquid separated. I found this out by running jar tests. I would set up beakers filled with wastewater, start the mixing paddle, add a dose of polymer flocculant. Right away, that water begins to separate. I would then stop the mixing and allow settling to occur. This process frees up much more liquid that otherwise would not separate. This is a better image of what it looks like. I did this process many times before I could find that optimal dose. Then I took that optimal dose and split it in half. Now I have my two polymer dosages. With that separated liquid, I filtered, extracted the DNA, and quantified specific genes in that liquid. I targeted three genes used in antibiotic resistance research. In Taiwan, which is indicative of mobile multi-antibiotic resistance. SOL1 encodes for sulfonamides, which is the first class of antibiotics mass produced. And BLAS-CTX, which encodes for last resort antibiotics. First, I looked at results using branched polymer at those two dosages, half and optimal. As you can see, half that polymer dosage achieved up to a 75% reduction of BLAS-CTX, which is those last resort antibiotics, which is really important to remove. But half that dosage barely did anything to remove in Taiwan, which is not ideal. Then I looked at optimal dosage. I measured up to a 99.9% reduction of all three targeted genes. So with a branched polymer, optimal dosage is kind of needed. Then I looked at linear polymer. At that half dosage, I measured a 97% reduction of BLAS-CTX and a 66% reduction of NTI1. Then, at that optimal dosage, I measured again up to a 99.9% reduction of all three genes. So, by choosing a linear polymer, utilities could save a little bit money by using a little less polymer, while still achieving that good reduction of antibiotic resistance genes. What we've learned is there are antibiotic resistance genes that, if untreated, are recycled through the treatment process. And we know that treatment plants use polymer flocculants. But by choosing the right polymer structure and optimal dosage, this can be a way to reduce the spread of antibiotic resistance within the treatment plant. Thank you.
Thank you, Amanda. Our next presenter today is Pratik Kanal, a PhD student in computer science. He will be presenting Quantifying Emotion in Music, a Novel Approach. Let's hear it for Pratik.
Thank you, Karina. Hello and namaste, everyone. As Karina said, my name is Pratik. So did that music get you pumped up? Yes? I heard a lot of claps. Music can get you pumped up, or calm you down, or make you feel better when you're upset. The bottom line is, there's a strong connection between music and emotion. And there's a lot of research in this topic, which is what I do, music emotion recognition. In other words, trying to quantify the emotions in music. But why are we interested in this? Well, there are a lot of applications. The first and very popular application is in automatic music recommendation and generation. Music streaming apps like Spotify, Apple, and YouTube, they use music data to create these personalized playlists based on the moods of the listener. Another major application is in entertainment. In movies and TV shows, where music is used to create and reinforce emotions in the audience. And the third application, where we really think this can make a difference, is in music therapy, where music can help patients with depression, autism, trauma, among several other conditions. However, there are some roadblocks in research on music emotion recognition. Currently, there are no large publicly available labeled data sets of emotion and music. Researchers don't have access to these data sets because of copyright issues. And there are no reliable tools for emotion recognition using audio sources. And emotion labeling studies using human participants are difficult, time-consuming, and expensive to conduct. So that's where my research comes in. What if we could leverage existing resources that are already available to us to estimate the emotional qualities of a piece of music? My goal is to create a large public data set of emotions for classical music, which are free of copyrights. And I aim to accomplish this using concert program notes, which are again free to use and publicly available. Specifically, with the use of AI and text analysis, I want to assign pseudo-annotations of emotions for classical music using program notes. Program notes are written texts like this. You get them whenever you go to classical music concerts, symphony orchestras, or operas. Every music piece that is performed in the concert has its own program note. And these texts, they contain a lot of information. But the very old program notes, they describe the music with a beautiful use of flowery and often poetic language that is very high in emotional information about the music. And that's what I'm trying to extract. I'm creating a novel data set containing concert program notes from more than 180 years of historical program note data. And I'm labeling each of the program notes with emotional values. But wait a minute, how do we assign these emotional values? Well, I'm using a very popular emotion model that quantifies emotion into a two-dimensional space of continuous numerical values that you can see in the picture, based on valence, which describes the pleasantness of something from negative to positive scale, and arousal, that describes the excitedness from low to high. And I'm using a standardized data set of nearly 14,000 English words, which have already been assigned with these values. To give you an idea of what emotion-related words might be inside program notes and the values assigned to them, let's see an example. Here, the word overwhelming is assigned with valence and arousal values between 0 and 1. So we do the same for the word gloom, and so on for the other words. So this allows me to get an overall estimate of the emotional content of each program note. In addition to everything, I'm also building a large language AI model that learns from our current data set and will be able to generalize and predict the values of valence and arousal for completely new program notes that are not previously been seen by our model. In conclusion, with this research, we aim to open the door to this entirely novel approach in the field of music emotion recognition. That's my time. Thank you so much, everyone. You have been a wonderful audience.
Thank you, Prateek, for the wonderful talk. It was very rock and roll. Our next presenter is Tema Telawu, a PhD student in computer science. Tema's presentation is Garbage In, Gospel Out, Detecting Anomalies in Weather Sensor Networks. Please join me in welcoming Tema to the stage.
Thank you, Eric, and thank you, everyone, for making time to attend my talk today. As Eric said, my name is Tema Telawu. I work on anomaly detection in weather sensor network. Before I start my talk, I would like to ask you a simple question. How many of you check the weather forecast at least once a week? Almost everyone, thank you. We use weather prediction in daily life all the time. Most of us check the weather app in the morning to decide what to wear. Airline companies and air traffic controllers are looking at the weather to plan flights. Another major application is agriculture. Accurately predicting weather is critical for agriculture in most parts of the world. Africa leads the charge in this, where more than 95% of the cultivated land relies on rainfall for irrigation. Latin America is not so far away, with 90% of the farmland sustained by rainfall. And this is 60% in South Asia. It is therefore critical that we accurately predict the amount of precipitation to allow farmers to know when to plant crops, when to harvest them, or when not to. The way we predict weather is using a sensor network. Here is an illustration of a sensor network. You can look at them as a team of weather watchers. that are strategically placed to observe the atmosphere. They track measurements such as atmospheric pressure, relative humidity, solar radiation, and most importantly, precipitation. Do you remember the continent in the world that needs agriculture the most? That needs rainfall the most for agriculture? That's right. It's Africa. But it's ironic because Africa is also the continent that has the worst sensor coverage in the world. That's a major gap. Our goal is to fill this gap and make Africa the continent with the best coverage. The project I'm working on is the Trans-African Hydrometeorological Observatory Network, or TAMO. We currently have about 1,000 weather stations distributed across 22 countries. Our goal is 20,000 weather stations, and this is to cover the entire African continent, 54 countries. For us, precipitation is the most important of the variables, but it's also the most challenging and the most complicated one. The reason is the problem with precipitation sensors is that they get clogged, and they start reporting zero precipitation even on rainy days. That's a problem. This is because the issue is, in most of the days, we expect zero to be the correct value. For example, in the country of Namibia, it is dry 300 days a year on average. This tells us that when our sensor was saying that it was dry, it's accurate most of the time. However, when it is dry, those sensors get dirty, and then they get clogged. So when it starts raining again, they are still reporting zero precipitation. That's an anomaly. Here is an example of a precipitation sensor. What you see on the left, we have a rain funnel at the top that collects water when it rains, and that water drips down the hole that you see in the middle, and as it falls in the bucket that we see on the right, there's a drip counter that measures the amount of precipitation. This is what it looks like when such a sensor is blocked. Now the question is, why do we care? Why does it matter? The answer is simple. The way we predict future weather is using present and past data. If our data is inaccurate, our prediction would be wrong. So we need to be able to detect those anomalies. And the question is therefore, how do we find those clogged sensors? How do we detect them? That's what I'm working on. That's my project. Going back to our illustration, suppose sensor A is not working correctly. We want to be able to detect it and quickly so we can fix it. The way we do that is using machine learning. We have data from the past at some of our stations and their neighbors. So we know that data is clean. So we are using that data along with the nearby stations to build the computational model of the working behavior of each sensor. Now, when our sensors are reporting the data every day, we can feed those data into our models to predict what is the amount of precipitation we expect. So let's say if we have sensors in Albany, Eugene, we can use them to predict what we expect to see in Corvallis as precipitation. Now, we compare the prediction that our model has produced with the observed value that our sensor has collected. When there is a discrepancy, then we know there is probably an anomaly there. The question becomes, how do we know that our system's detected anomaly is correct? How do we know that they are not lying to us? The way we do this is by using a data to evaluate how our model is doing. Here is an example of precipitation collected at one of our stations over 1 year. So what you see on the vertical axis is the amount of rain. On the horizontal axis are the days of the year. So what we do is we simulate a blocked rain gauge, or we add synthetic anomalies by changing some of the days where there was precipitation into zero. That's what the yellow part of the graph is highlighting. Now the question is, we know that we added those synthetic anomalies, but we want to know how good our models are at detecting those anomalies. Suppose the anomaly starts on day 100. So suppose that the sensor was working correctly until day 100, and then it got clogged. If our model detects that there was an anomaly on day 80, that's a false alarm. because on day 80, the sensor was still working correctly. It could be a big problem because every time our system raises an alarm, we want to fix it. So we have to send the technician to the field to go and inspect the sensors. When you have a network of 20,000 stations, you don't want to have a lot of false alarm. It is very expensive. However, on the other hand, if our sensor says that normally started on day 110, then we have a 10-day delay. We don't want that either, because the 10 days that the system failed to detect, we're having garbage data in our system. We don't want that. So our goal is to be able to detect anomaly with very short delay and also very false positive. Now, I hope that when I'm talking to you again in a few years, we have our 20,000 weather stations working correctly and reporting reliable data. And then the continent that right now needs rainfall the most is the continent with the best weather sensor infrastructure in the world. And our farmers in Africa are able to take the predictions that we make as gospel thanks to our anomaly detection systems that help us detect garbage sensors and produce reliable data. Thank you.
Thank you, Timma, for the excellent talk. And better late than never, let's give it up for Karina for emceeing an excellent first half.
Oh my God, you nailed it.
Thank you.
Next up, we have Marie Oland, a PhD student in environmental engineering. She'll be presenting her work on forensic chemistry, detecting chemicals and biosolids. Marie, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Eric, and thank you everyone for being here today. As Eric said, today I'll be talking about biosolids, specifically identifying the chemicals in biosolids and taking the toxic ones out. So remember this diagram? As we heard, biosolids are the solid waste that comes out of the wastewater treatment plant. So they get treated and they leave. And biosolids have some pretty cool benefits when mixed into soil. They help lock up carbon, which can help reduce our carbon footprint. When mixed into agricultural soil, they're super nutrient rich and so can help increase our crop yields. And if we actually use them, then they're not going to landfills, which is where about half of our biosolids go in some places. Sounds pretty cool, right? Unfortunately, biosolids also have a couple downsides, one of which is they are filled with chemicals. So think along the lines of personal care products like soaps, deodorant, toothpaste, pharmaceutical products like antibiotics, medication, anything that stormwater runoff picks up, like heavy metals and pesticides. Basically, anything that goes down a drain, any drain, has chemicals in them, and they end up in our wastewater treatment plant. And if they don't get treated properly, they end up in our biosolids. And so you can imagine, all of these chemicals in our biosolids is a problem, especially if we're going to be growing food out of this soil. And I'm not trying to scare you, because they're not all necessarily harmful, and some of these chemicals do get treated and removed. But which chemicals and to what degree, we don't know. The good news is, that's what I'm working on. My first research question is better understanding what chemicals are actually in these biosolids. And how do I do this? I use the same instrument we heard in Lorinda's talk, a liquid chromatograph and mass spectrometer. And this allows me to separate and detect the tens of thousands of chemicals in biosolids. The method I use is called non-target analysis, which lets me detect everything in these samples. And what's great about this method is it doesn't limit my search, but unfortunately the way this instrument works is it fragments my chemicals into pieces. And so I don't have any chemical names associated with these fragments, and I have to do a little detective work. Basically, I get this huge file with masses, retention times, and intensities for each of those individual fragments. This file, for example, had 80,000 chemical fragments. And this gives me a much more complete picture of what's actually in these biosolids. But as I said, we don't know what chemicals these fragments belong to. So what I can do next is compare these masses and retention times to databases to get a list of chemicals that were probably in my sample, or what we call suspected chemicals. Chemicals that fraction the same way or have the same retention time are probably the same chemical. And so here, for example, we can see the black fragments that we measured from the instrument line up very well with the red chemical from the database. And so we can be pretty sure this chemical was in our samples. Here, not so much. And so now I have a list of all the chemical fragments in biosolids and a slightly smaller list of suspected chemicals in biosolids. Which brings me to my next research question. How do we actually remove all of these chemicals? And is our removal method effective? The approach I'm using is bioremediation, which is just the use of a biological agent, in my case bacteria, to remove these pollutants in a more natural and cost-effective way. The way I do this is by loading a syringe with bacterial cells and this gelatiny substance. I slowly release this mixture, a few drops at a time, into a vat of cross-linking solution. This solidifies the beads with the cells inside of them, giving them extra protection. Then I make lots of soil pots to actually test these beads. I have a pot of soil alone and biosolids alone as baselines, a pot of mixed soil and biosolids, and a pot of soil, biosolids, and those beads. And then I let them do their thing. Over time, the bacteria literally eat away at the chemicals. I'll sample every couple weeks, and after a couple months, they'll have done their thing, and I can analyze what has happened. I'll do the same chemical analysis, get the same big sheet, and run statistical tests on those resulting suspect and fragments lists, on their patterns and trends in their chemical composition. This work is still in progress, but here's an example of what that might look like. Samples that are very similar or have the same chemicals in them should cluster together. So ideally, we'll see the biosolid samples cluster together, and then the soil samples making their own separate cluster because of their different chemical compositions. And then hypothetically, we should also see the pot of the soil and mixed biosolids fall somewhere in between those two. And then if treatment was successful, we should see a completely separate cluster for the samples that came with the pots with the beads, indicating some sort of chemical change in that pot. And then I can use the suspected chemicals list to actually figure out which of those chemicals went away with treatment, if any increased or didn't go away over time that we should pay extra attention to. Some other cool things I can do with this data is look at DNA from those same samples. I can get a better idea then of which bacterial strains are removing which specific chemicals. I can also run toxicity tests on some of those chemicals that either increased over time or didn't go away that are of particular concern. But in the end, all this helps us determine how much risk we're actually introducing by mixing our soil and biosolids and potential ways of naturally reducing these chemical risks, so that hopefully we can safely and sustainably reuse our biosolids without putting chemicals in our food and environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Marie, for the great talk. Up next is Trinity Armstrong, a PhD student in robotics. Trinity is studying how to use robots to nudge. Please welcome Trinity.
Thanks, Eric. Hi, everyone. And as Eric said, I'm Trinity. Now, what do I mean when I say I'm using robots to nudge? I'm not using them to nudge you physically. I'm using them to nudge you behaviorally. So in other words, we're pushing you to subconsciously make a certain decision. Now, nudging is used in a wide variety of fields, so places like e-commerce, social media, and advertising. A good example of this would be in your food delivery apps. So think of DoorDash or Uber Eats. As you scroll through the restaurants, you might see something under one of the restaurant titles that says 90% of people like this, or you might see a particularly bolded 4.5 out of 5 stars. That's the app trying to nudge you to pick that restaurant over the others. And that's what I mean when I say nudging. But where do robots come into this? So a while back, a professor in occupational health approached my advisor and I. He wants to increase safety in highly challenging occupational settings. So settings like construction, commercial fishing, and wildfire fighting. He wants to collaborate with us to make a robot that can be used to help prevent exhaustion and injuries in these settings. So, my professor is interested in human-robot interaction, and she introduced me to the concept of robot-mediated nudging. And that's just when you use robots to nudge. From here, we decided to focus on the problem of exhaustion. To do this, we wanted to make a robot that could be used to nudge people to go to bed at better times or to just make better sleep decisions in general. Now, we didn't want to make a robot that was just a glorified alarm clock that said, it's time to go to bed. We wanted to do something different. We wanted to design a robot that would appeal to people, tug at their heartstrings, and make them feel or say, I don't want to make my robot sad or disappoint my robot. So we came up with the concept, a doggy, a robot pet. So this is just a very low fidelity prototype at the moment, which basically just means that we're really early in the design process. But this is what we plan for it to do. Our dog will be on your nightstand and will track your sleep as you sleep, tracking things like your movement, making sure that you're sleeping soundly. And then when you wake up, it will give you a very brief report about your sleep quality. So it'll say like your sleep quality was good, okay, or poor. And then based on your previous night's sleep quality, the doggy will nudge you to try to go to bed at a better time. So for example, if you had poor sleep quality the night before, your doggy might start to whine and beg and ask you to come to bed just a bit earlier than you did the night before to try and make up for all of that poor sleep that you had the night before. So how do we plan to monitor this? We're gonna use a smartwatch, so something like a Fitbit or an Apple Watch, and we'll just modify it to be able to talk to the dog. How do we plan to test the effectiveness of our robot? We're gonna run a study, a 4-week-long study. So during the span of this 4 weeks, we'll monitor participants' sleep habits and sleep quality, and for 2 weeks of the study, the participants will have access to the robot, and for the other 2 weeks, the participants will not use the robot, and we'll just use that as something called a control or a baseline to compare the robot to. So next steps. We want to finish our prototyping for the robot. We want to modify our smartwatch. And finally, we want to start recruiting participants for our study. So for this particular study, we'll actually be using something called a convenience population, which is just a population of people that are easier to get a hold of than the workers in those highly challenging occupational settings that I mentioned before. So we'll be recruiting here at OSU. And OSU is a really good place to recruit for participants for this because I'm sure a lot of you don't have the best sleep habits. So, stepping back, what's our question? Can we use robots to nudge people to make better sleep decisions? I think our doggy can help, but we'll see. Thank you.
Thank you, Trinity, for the wonderful talk. Up next is Stephen Contra, a dual master's student in civil engineering and wood science. His presentation is Earthquakes and Tall Timber Buildings, Testing Full-Scale Designs. Welcome, Stephen.
Thank you, Eric, for the introduction. Hi, everyone. I'm Stephen. This is what I do. So you may be wondering, do you guys give dance lessons to buildings in civil engineering? Well, not exactly, but you're not too far off. We put buildings through earthquakes over and over and over again to test their performance. What you're seeing here is a full-scale, 68-foot-tall, 6-story building that's composed of timber products specifically engineered for large-scale applications that we call mass timber. This mass timber building is sitting atop the world's largest outdoor earthquake simulator, or shake table. This shake table can simulate any earthquake in recorded history. Just imagine you were a giant and you could pick up a 68-foot building and place it in a massive earthquake anywhere in the world in any point in recorded history. That's what we can do with this. What you saw in the video was a simulation of the infamous 1994 Northridge earthquake that struck the Bay Area 30 years ago. This earthquake took 57 lives and caused $60 billion in damages and economic loss. So how do we make sure history does not repeat itself? How can we prepare our communities to face such a risk? Well, the most efficient way we can prepare is to design our buildings to be resilient. Resilience is a critical concept in structural engineering, and it refers to how quickly a building can bounce back after a natural disaster. We measure this on a spectrum, where a building that can be fully operational right after an earthquake, that's resilient. A building we need to demolish, not so much. Now, when we talk about resilience in the past century, for tall buildings, we're primarily talking about the use of two materials, concrete and steel. In fact, as it stands today, 99% of non-residential construction use concrete and steel as their primary structural material. That's a big problem for our planet, because just the production of these two materials alone account for 12% of global greenhouse gas emissions. To put that in perspective, if concrete and steel formed one country, they would be the number three emitter of greenhouse gases worldwide, only behind, guess who? The United States and China. For this reason, researchers all over the world are looking for ways to make our buildings more sustainable. And mass timber is a very promising alternative. These products are strong, they're versatile, but best of all, they can be produced at a fraction of the carbon footprint. Let's think about how we get timber products in the first place. They're from trees. Trees take in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and they store that carbon within their very wood fiber. And that carbon can be retained in wood products and can be stored in buildings. Essentially, we're turning our buildings into carbon storage devices. Now, mass timber is still relatively novel, so you may be wondering, what does it look like when you put mass timber in large buildings? I'm not sure if you realized, but mass timber designs have been embraced widely, even here in Oregon, and even right here on this very campus. Anyone walk through the College of Forestry lately? Or perhaps you've heard of the new Collaborative Innovation Complex coming in 2025. That'll be mass timber too. And oh yeah, anyone flying into Portland starting this summer will be greeted by one of the grandest displays of mass timber construction anywhere in the world. Let's get back to our building. In our building, we're testing a new mass timber technology that's resilient and scalable for tall buildings. We call it a mass timber rocking wall. We also sometimes refer to it as a structural spine. Why? Because the rocking wall serves a similar purpose for the building as the spine does for our bodies. When the earthquake shakes the building, the spine makes sure that all the buildings, all the floors are moving together so it's one building, and also has a self-centering capability such that after the shaking, the building can come back into alignment. Now, we don't just shake these buildings for the joy of watching them dance. We implement a specific test program to learn everything we can about mass timber designs and how mass timber buildings behave in earthquakes. We fitted our building with 700 sensors to measure things like how fast the floors are accelerating, how components are moving relative to each other, and how the building is moving and drifting in the earthquake. And once we had our sensors installed, we subjected our building to 244 earthquakes sourced from all over the world, of all different types, and of all levels of magnitude. And you might expect a building to go through so many earthquakes to be in pretty rough shape, right? Well, that's not the case. We saw no structural damage at any phase of shaking. What does this mean for us? It means we can design mass timber buildings to the highest level of resiliency. From our tests, we collected a tremendous amount of data that we can use to validate our design approaches. And we can share this validated design approach with the engineering community that lets them perform their own resilient designs using sustainable mass timber material. My friends, our building sector is ready for something new that's resilient and sustainable. I say, it's time we shake things up. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen, for the excellent talk. Our last research presentation is from Rachel Thompson, a PhD student in bioengineering. Her talk is on spinal disc research, a new solution. Let's hear it for Rachel.
Well, thank you, Eric, and thank you everyone for being here today for the showcase. We're almost done, I promise. So picture this. One day you wake up and your lower back starts hurting. Now, this isn't a, I can take an ibuprofen and everything will work out through the rest of the day sort of pain. This pain is sharp, it's coming on quick, and it's really impacting your daily life. So you go to your physician and they diagnose you with the leading cause of disability worldwide. You are now one of 619 million people who will get this incredibly technical diagnosis of low back pain. So why is this happening? Well, in between the vertebrae of our spine are these cartilage discs that let each of us move and bend and flex every single day. But what we see over time are these discs begin to degenerate, causing herniation, or as most of us probably know it, as getting a slipped disc. If you think of your back as a jelly donut, it'd be going like this. That's the jelly spilling out of the disc onto your nerves, causing you severe pain. Now, when we look at treatments, we mainly have two options. One, you can live with it, manage the pain, I hope it gets better. Or two, if the pain is that severe, surgery. Now, that's not a lot of options. And that's because when we look at creating new treatments, we want to research with whole human discs, mainly for the accuracy and also so we reduce the amount of animal studies. But when we harvest these discs from organ donors, the clock immediately starts and cells within the disc die very quickly. We simply cannot keep cells alive in these discs long enough. So, even when the research gets done, it's difficult to duplicate and validate the results. We need a method of keeping these cells alive. And that's what my research is all about. So to do that, I use a method called cryopreservation. And this means freezing, but not like the kitchen and your chicken freezer freezing. It's deep freezing. It's negative 135 degrees Celsius freezing. The great thing, we can keep these cells in the discs alive in a state of sort of suspended animation until we need them for the research. Now, this sounds simple enough, so why isn't it already done? Well, cryopreservation is a difficult process. We can't just whack some discs into negative 135 degrees Celsius. It'd be like giving someone frostbite. So we need to use specific chemicals to protect the cells as they're being frozen. Now for the bad news. The chemicals can damage the cells if they're not frozen quickly. And it can take a while for those cells to absorb all of that liquid. So we need to speed up the process of getting those protective chemicals into all parts of the disc from those outer structures into that inner jelly. And to do this, we use compression. We squish the discs just a little bit to let them soak up all of that protectant chemical. And I mean, you can think of it as a kitchen sponge. You wring out the sponge, you put it in water, you let it go, and you watch it swell. That's what's happening to those actual discs in my lab. So this all sounds great, but does it work? When we stain for viability, we know that green is alive and red is dead. With fresh discs, ones that haven't been compressed and haven't been cryopreserved, it's very green, so the cells are alive. But with discs that have been cryopreserved but not compressed, red is very dead. Versus discs that have been compressed and cryopreserved, it's like a forest. It's very green, the cells are alive. We can see with our own eyes that compression is key to keeping these cells alive. By combining cryopreservation and compression, researchers can find new treatments to help those 619 million people with low back pain. Well, thank you.
Great job, Rachel. What a wonderful way to wrap up this year's research talks. But wait, there is more. Before we close the program, I'd like to invite to the stage the Associate Dean for Graduate Programs in the College of Engineering and the person who was responsible for creating this whole event, Cora Bordell.
Thanks, everybody, and thank you, Eric, but I really can't take credit. This was a huge team effort. We have an amazing external relations team who made tonight's event so wonderful, and some generous funding from the Devons put an extra special spin on tonight. But of course, not everything can go perfectly in an event like tonight. We did actually plan on having 11 wonderful speakers, but halfway through our preparation process about a month ago, one of our speakers, Courtney Berenger, tore her ACL and had surgery last night. So you'll excuse her for not being on stage today. And it is also why I am very thankful that I never made a break your leg reference earlier on, or I would feel very guilty. But Courtney said she'd be watching online, so I hope she's doing well, recovering online with many other watchers online. Thank you to everyone who couldn't come in person but is still engaging, and maybe I didn't tell you, there's hundreds of people also watching you online. But I hope you all got as much out of tonight as I did. I think we all knew that engineers were builders, but maybe you didn't know that engineering researchers are also builders, but their building blocks are physics, chemistry, biology, and mathematics. And maybe that doesn't come out unless you get to see engineering research spoken about like we saw today. These students pulled the hood off the cover of what goes on into their hard work that went into not just preparing to speak tonight, but all of the hard research that they did leading up to this point. Some of our students are very close to the end of their degrees, and some are just starting, so you got to see what it's like to talk about research early on in the stages, that planning part, as well as what completed research looks like. If you think this might be for you, graduate study is available to everyone. We have 14 wonderful graduate programs across the College of Engineering. Come find me out at the reception if you want to learn more. We also have 3 graduate ambassadors, and you can't see anything when you're up on stage. They're in the back corner. They will be out at a table with materials about our graduate programs as well. This work that our students did is not innate. It's learned. These students were chosen basically just on their willingness to get up on stage and having written about a story to tell. There were no demos. There were no auditions to do this. And that's just like becoming a graduate engineering researcher yourself. It is learned. It's not innate. So one final thing as a raffle. Ah, there we go. Thank you. All right. So we have a raffle tonight. Maybe I'll get you to hold this for me. Thank you. Okay. So if you can get out your raffle tickets, start reading out numbers. Are they all going to start with the same numbers? Probably. All right. Raffle ticket number 1, 0, 2, 7, 2. Another 2, 8. Do we have a winner? Woo! I think our graduate ambassadors are making their way with some wonderful swag bags for you. All right, ticket number 2, 0, 2, 7, 0, 9, 4. We have a winner. Yay, woo! All right. Ticket number 3, 027. I think we've all learned the pattern. 1, 0, 2. Woo! Thank you. 0, 2, 7, 1, 1, 4. Woo! One more? Thanks. All right, the last one. 0, 2, 7, 1, 9, 5. Oh, all the way in the back corner. Thank you! So thank you all for a wonderful evening. I'm going to turn it back to our wonderful MCs, but I'd like us to all give Karina and Eric a thank you too.
Thank you, Cora, and a big thank you to all our presenters and to everybody for joining us today.
We hope you can also join us for the reception in the lobby. Well, you'll be meeting the presenters there and, of course, having some delicious free food. In the meantime, we'd like to invite all our speakers to the stage for a photo. Let's have one final round of applause for all our speakers today. You may now exit and feel free to go to the reception.
Leave. Nice. Woo!